I'm going to talk about laser stop buttons today on this live stream, something I've been working on the last week or so. So I just thought I might as well make a live stream about it. We all love a bit of nerdy live streams, don't we? This is what I'm talking about. It's a prototype stop button. For those of you who don't know, when you're using display lasers, you should always connect an emergency stop button. They need to be connected to the laser in a particular way through a connector on the laser known as an interlock. You mustn't ever put a stop button directly into the mains. You should never just let a stop button actually just disconnect the mains. Lasers do unpredictable things when that happens. Don't do that. Instead, use the actual interlock system in the laser. So the interlock system in a laser is often an RJ45 socket, you know, an Ethernet socket. Sometimes it's an XLR. Older lasers sometimes use like serial DB7 connectors, I think. But usually, most of my modern lasers use an RJ45, and they all use different pins, of course. But the concept is that two of the pins, whatever the laser wants, they need to be connected to each other. The loop needs to be closed in order for the laser to be active. So it's pretty easy to just get a stop button, figure out the wiring, plug it into your laser. The stop button is normally closed, and when you push the button, it goes open, which stops the laser working. Most of the lasers I've got just work exactly this way, but actually there is a standard for display laser safety, and this is what I have to look up. It's the EN60825 relating to display lasers, and in that safety spec, it says that when you push a button, when you do a stop button, then when you release it, the laser shouldn't come on until you then subsequently push a start button. Right, so this is a prototype. Normally it would also have a key switch in the laser, it would also have a key switch in the button so that you couldn't reactivate the button once it's pushed without the key. But ignoring that for a minute, this is a prototype of the system. You can see I push the button, the red light goes off. It means that the laser is disabled. If I want to re-enable it, I release the stop button. Nothing happens until I push the start button. I personally don't quite know why it needs that extra start button step. Perhaps it's so that you actually need to consciously decide to start a laser. I guess there's an argument for that. I don't know. I guess I don't mind it. I suppose we should try and adhere to the standards wherever they exist. So this feature of having the start button isn't built into most, I think all of my lasers. Some lasers, I think Gavant lasers, have this built into the laser and they have stop buttons that can do it. But for all my lasers, they don't have this feature. It's just either the button is pushed and the laser is off, or the button is released and the laser is on. My friend Andy wanted to see if I could come up with an active stop button that had that extra functionality built in. And so that's what I've built here. Slight downside to it is it does need an external power supply. There's ways I can get around that in future with some of my systems. But for now, this is the solution that Andy will be using. So how do you do that electronics so that there's that two-step process to re-enabling the laser? Well, I must admit, I didn't really know, right? I didn't know how to do this. All of my, you know, I'm very experienced with electronics, but it's all to do with like programming electronics. So it's all with microcontrollers. My skills in kind of discrete logic circuits and basic circuitry is pretty limited. I mean, I get the basics, but anything more complicated, I usually do with a microcontroller. So to try and come back to more discrete logic, it was something new to me. So I looked around a little bit and I discovered that I could use this system called an SR latch. Let me see if I can switch screens. There we are. So this is the SR latch. It's made out of two NOR gates, right? It's a logic gate that outputs a 1 if the two inputs are both the same, are both off, both different, right? So if they're both off, it's not or, so it's if they're both the same, it outputs a 1. Oh, I've already confused myself. I haven't even started the video yet. It's atrocious. I'm going to cut in right here because Seb from the past is getting very confused about OR and NOR gates. So an OR gate outputs 1 if either of the inputs is 1. So a NOR gate only outputs a 1 if none of the inputs are on. So it's only outputs true if both inputs are false. Okay, back to the other Seb. So there's this method of using, of putting these NOR gates together in such a way that the output of one feeds into the input of another. And this becomes what's known as an SR latch. It's set reset latch. And you can see the lookup table for it here, but it's probably easier if I just show you how it works, right? I've got one that I mocked up here. Let's see if I can... Oh, I need to move the camera. I really haven't thought this through. Expert YouTuber. Let's wonder if I can show you my desk. There it is. Oh, I think I might need to close. Can I open it? Oh, it's all going to... Oh, I hope I can edit this stream later. Hold on. Yeah, there we are. Let's zoom into that. Okay, so here's an SR latch implementation. I actually got this from... I learned a lot about this from Ben Eater, the YouTuber. He's so good. You should definitely subscribe to Ben Eater. He's brilliant. And it was he who showed me this design for an SR latch. So you can see we've got power here. Essentially, each one of these LEDs is connected to each one of the outputs on the SR latch, like here. So one LED is connected to Q, and one LED is connected to not Q. The set and reset are connected to buttons. So you can see it's very simple. If I push one button, one LED goes on. If I push the other button, the other LED goes on. Well, that's cool, but how does that do the functionality of my stop button? Because if you think about it, the stop button... the button is on. If I turn it off, it goes off. If I turn it back on again, nothing happens. If I push this button, then it goes active. So how do I turn this into this? Well, it turns out that I had to reverse one of these buttons. So at the moment, when I push it, it goes high. But if I just change the wiring of this, so that when I push it, it goes low, that means that it behaves slightly differently, right? So now, like if this is the stop button, normally closed, so if I close that, that's the equivalent of me turning, releasing this stop button to be open, but the switch is closed. Very confusing. But me pushing down on this button is the equivalent of this stop button being released or enabled or closed, whatever terminology. And then this blue button is the equivalent of the start button there. You notice now when I push that, it switches. I can push that over and over again and it stays on, nothing happens. It's the same as me pushing this over and over. But when I let go of this, it's the equivalent of me hitting the stop button and it goes to the other state. And now pushing the start button doesn't do anything significant. Right, so this is the circuit. I have to then design it as a PCB. Let's get this camera back up to me. Oh, extreme close-up, you don't need to see that. Okay. Oh, such an expert. Oh, jeez. It's going well, right? I'm a real professional. You must be very impressed right now. What do I... Oh, it's this knob. I'm doing the wrong knob. Sorry. Okay. We're good, are we? Okay. So I took that circuit design into KiCad or KiCad, depending on how you want to call it. And it's here, right? But you'll notice there's a few extra components here. So let me just talk you through this circuit board. This chip here has four NOR gates in it. So it's actually, I only need two NOR gates. So it's a bit overkill. You can also make a NOR gate out of two transistors. So I could have recreated this circuit with four transistors, but I thought it'd be easier to just use one chip for everything. And the chips are really cheap, right? So I might as well. So this chip here is handling the two NOR gates, feeding from one into the other. That's all cool. What else have I got? Well, I've got this here, which is a photo relay, and that is controlling the interlock for the laser. So that's responsible for putting the two wires of the laser interlock together and enabling the laser. I notice a comment saying it's futile, can't stop a laser. Well, no, I suppose not once it's active, but there... Yeah, lots of fun silly laser related comments. Okay, so that's this. This is the there's four NOR gates in this chip. I'm using two of them. Then here is the photo relay that controls the interlock. I said that already. So what is this here? Well, that is a low dropout voltage regulator. So that means I can get a very wide range of voltage inputs and they'll be converted into 5 volts. I think it goes from like 6 volts to maybe 20 volts or something like that. So there's a real wide range of inputs. I can put almost anything into this and it'll be fine. So what else? Well, there's a bunch of capacitors. This requires a couple of capacitors. The resistors are for the LEDs and for the photo relay. And then there's a couple of 10K, one's a pull up and one's a pull down resistor. And then here are all the outputs. The reset button and VCC, that goes to the push button. That goes to this. The stop, these are the two LED signals. So power LED is the yellow one. Active LED is the, I just realized you can't see my mouth. Active LED is the red one that comes on when the laser is active. And then these two buttons, the stop button and the ground, that actually goes to the button itself. So, where are we at? Well, I got these made up. Oh, I've got a fun time-lapse video. Let's have a look. So this is me soldering up the... Oh no, here we are. This is me soldering up those boards. I did four at once. I find it a lot easier to do four at once. But it was, I'm quite used to doing like manual surface mount soldering, but this was kind of a bit intense even for me. I was using 0603 components, which are so small, they're like dust, right? They're totally like dust. It's funny because when you first start doing surface mount soldering, it just, like, if you see other people doing it, it just looks like magic, right? I found with a bit of practice, it gets kind of manageable. You need magnifying goggles. They're critical. You need a really good soldering iron that's temperature controlled and a really fine tip. And as you might be able to see in the time lapse, I'm using lots of flux and I like to use the flux pens. I find those really good. So with you, when you use a flux pen, essentially the solder just goes to all the pads. You don't even have to worry about it. Okay, so I've got some questions in the comments. What is a photo relay? Well, sprouting potato, I assume you know what an actual relay is, but just in case, a relay is a switch that can be controlled with electricity. So if you want to use a low voltage to turn on a high voltage, a common way to do that is with a relay. Like say if you want to turn on a light in your room with like an Arduino, you'd use a relay. The 5 volts from the Arduino can power a relay that turns on a switch that the mains power is connected to. A photo relay is a non-mechanical version of that. I'm going to get into trouble because I don't really know how it works. I think someone asked in the comments, is it an opto-isolator? I believe it's kind of similar to an opto-isolator. Essentially, you're turning on an LED in this photo relay, and through magic, the other two contacts are connected. It's a lot easier to work with than a standard relay. Traditional relays take a lot of current, plus you also need to put a flyback diode in it because there's a bit of back EMF when the switch shuts. You might get a little spike in the other direction, as with any electric coil. So I find photo relays a lot easier to work with. Okay, so I think that's probably all that I wanted to show you. I've got some of the boards here actually. Let's just get... So here's the final thing. Of course, I'd made it in such a way as to be configured one way, but my friend Andy always needs it slightly differently. So like in my version, this has like an Ethercon connector like this. So you can just plug it straight in. With Andy, he wanted to control the output. So I put a little screw terminal in there. He can just plug those two wires into his interlock. And you can see all the buttons and the LEDs on the outside here. So yeah, that's pretty much it. So an interesting little project. I feel fairly certain that anyone experienced with this kind of discrete logic might have been able to come up with a way easier way of doing it. I don't know. I'm not sure. This is very new to me. I was quite pleased that I could figure out how to get an SR latch to do what I wanted. Perhaps you know more efficient ways of doing it. I'd love to hear from you if you do. But yeah, a kind of fun, interesting project. Now it's done and ready to be sent off. Yeah, and it was an interesting one. So I hope you've enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. If there's any questions, I'll stick around a bit longer. Right. Yeah, there we are. And Sol Barnes, you may be about to get to this. What happens if the power is removed from the safety switch while in use? Well, that's a really good question, but it does the right thing. It fails safe. Let's say it's active. If I pull the power out, it goes off. The laser is disabled. You should always fail safe. But you might want to know what happens. Do you remember earlier on? Just for fun, I was going to do a whole video about this actually. But just for fun, I actually pulled the plug on a laser quite recently. Just to see, because you always hear like people saying, oh, you should never pull the plug on a laser. That's not a safe way to turn it off. Because, and I know why, because the scanners could go to an extreme point, so the laser could start behaving erratically. But in my experience, I've never actually seen that. I knew it's theoretically possible. But I thought the other day, let's try it. So I'll show you what happens. I've got this video of what happens if you pull the plug on a laser. Let's see, here it is. So you can see it running. I'm about to pull the plug out. Watch the pattern. Look, did you see that? It just went crazy. It went massive and wild and uncontrollable. Let's just run that again. There you go, here it comes. Whoa! So perhaps that's a good argument for why you should never just pull the power on a laser to shut it off. And that's why you should never put an emergency stop on the mains power for a laser. Okay, so I think that's probably it for now. Yeah, super geeky. I was kind of put off making really geeky videos, but when I did the one about PowerCon cables, you seem to really like it. So, so you're going to get more geeky, nerdy content from now on. That's it for this live stream. Thanks so much for joining us. Yeah, I'll see you next time.